The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
From Psalm 18, I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. Good morning and welcome to worship at First Presbyterian Church. This Sunday is Worldwide Communion Sunday, the Sunday where we celebrate that the gospel of Jesus Christ has spread all around the world. And today, people all around the world are celebrating communion together. Now, I think it's unique or symbolic that in a world that right now is dealing with a worldwide pandemic, that we can also celebrate the faith of Jesus Christ all around the world. If you're joining us via live stream, we trust that you'll be seeing a better picture today with our new equipment. They're glad that you can join us. If you're here in worship, we appreciate you following sessions instructions to wear a mask during worship. Our worship services are recorded and are available on our website as well as through KRAN radio at 8:30 on Sunday morning. We'll be sending out these announcements via our flock note and email, and we ask you to please pray for those on our prayer chain. We'll be having our fellowship time afterwards via Zoom. If you didn't receive the Zoom link, the number is 834-5395-6721. We're encouraging you to donate to the fire relief and hurricane relief through our church. If you want to, we'll be distributing money through the Presbyterians for Disaster Assistance. Simply write the check to our church and make noted on the memo line that it's for either the fire disasters or the hurricane relief. We'll be having a new members class for any of you who would like to consider becoming members, if you're not so already, on October 18th, beginning at noon. And this will be both in person and via Zoom. We have a minute for mission this morning from Tom Moback.
Thank you, Bob. Again, as he said, I'm Tom Moback. I'm with the Mission Committee, and I'm here to ask for your offerings about peace and global witness. The peace and global witness is our mission, our own mission to give to that, to have peace and promote God's peace or Christ's peace across the world. And we can do that, if we do that, 25% of it will stay with our church, and 25% will go to regional help with peace, and then 50% will go globally throughout the world of peace. And there's several different ways you can donate. This is in your bulletin. Of course, this handout is in your bulletin that tells you about it. And you can donate. There's an envelope out on the table. You can do that way. And up to my surprise, I didn't really realize it, but you can even text to donate now, or you can donate online with a credit card, or you just donate through the church. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. And yes, you can also donate through our website. Up our website and go to our donation page, it has it for special offering for the Peace and Global Witness offering. Pastor Diana, do you have an announcement and birthdays and anniversaries?
I do have an announcement before I get to the list of birthdays. The deacons have initiated a mission project for the next 2 weeks. There will be a collection point in the parlor. We are collecting items to send a military care package overseas. Belinda Smith's daughter, Heather Smith, is deployed, and we asked her for a list of things that might be useful for the unit, and she's provided that. It's in your bulletin. So if you are able to donate to that, we will have a collection spot in the church parlor for those, as well as the collection for the Mullen Fire donations. There's also a list of donate needed items for the firemen that are fighting the fires here in our state. So there's a list of items for that as well. If you would like to participate in either of those, it would be greatly appreciated. So today's birthday list is pretty long. It's amazing. Celebrating birthdays today, Elena Artson, and she's here, and it's her birthday today. As it is Kylie Finns, Kathy Lakes, and Kelly Thompson, all have birthdays today. K.K. Silzer, Jennifer Kaufman, Darwin Mangleri has birthday this week. Sharon Novick, Paula Qualls, So happy birthday, everyone. Did I miss anyone's birthday, or do you have any anniversaries you'd like to have announced?
And now may the peace of Christ be with you.
Would you please join with me in the call to worship, followed by the prayer of praise. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. Let us pray. We praise you for creating this world in all its beauty, for redeeming the world through Christ our Lord, and for sending us with your Spirit to encourage, instruct, and sustain us. We long for your Spirit to work among us now, to inspire our praise, to challenge us with your truth, and to equip us for service in your world. Amen.
I hope in truth.
month, we remember that we are people who have preferred our wills to His, accepting God's power to become new persons in Christ. Let us confess our sin before God and one another. Please join me in the prayer of confession. Awesome and compassionate God, you have loved us with unfailing, self-giving mercy. But we have not loved you. You constantly call us, but we do not listen. You ask us to love, but we walk away from neighbors in need, wrapped in our own concerns. We condone evil, prejudice, warfare, and greed. God of grace, as you come to us in mercy, we repent in spirit and in truth, admit our sin, and gratefully receive your forgiveness through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. And now let us take a moment for silent personal confession. Amen. And now let us hear these words of assurance of our pardon. Christ is our peace. Those who are divided, he has made one. He has broken down the barriers of separation by his death and has built us up into one body with God. To all who repent and believe, he has promised reconciliation. So live as people reconciled. Amen.
Please join with me in the prayer for illumination. Lord God, help us to know your ways and teach us your paths. Lead us in your truth, for you are the God of our salvation. For you we wait all day long. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Old Testament lesson today is from Psalm 51, verses 1 through 7. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you alone, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence and blameless when you pass judgment. Indeed, I was born guilty, a sinner when my mother conceived me. You desire truth in the inward being, therefore teach me wisdom in my secret heart. Purge me with hyssop and I shall be clean. Wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Thank you.
Thank you, Bell Choir. Our New Testament passage this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, verses 16 through 20. You are familiar with these words. Listen now to the Word of God. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age." The word of the Lord. I'd like to invite any children to come forward for the time for children today. Come on down and have a seat right on one of these X's here, if you would. Come on down. You can sit right there. Where are you going to sit? Right there, okay. Since you guys are family, you can sit together if you want. Well, good morning, boys and girls. Good morning. Well, last week, Miss Ashley had a bottle of water, didn't she? And she drank it. And do you remember the name for Jesus that she talked about last week? It was a. Do you remember what it was? What was it? Remember? It's hard. Jesus said, "I am the living water," didn't he? Well, this week we're going to talk about water also. What can you use water for? What do we do with water? What's some other things besides drinking it? Cooking with it? Yep. Drinking it? What else do we do? Putting it in lakes, and you can float on it and swim in it, right? Well, I want to talk about something else. If you go out and you're playing in the yard, and maybe you're rolling around in the dirt, or maybe you're planting a garden and working with the yard with your folks, do you get dirty, right? You come back in with dirty hands and dirt on you. How do you get clean? What do? You take a shower. You use water, don't you? You take soap and you water and you scrub it all down, don't you, to get clean. What about if we do something wrong? If we do something that we're not supposed to do, something we call a sin, what are examples of that? What are some examples of things that we call what? If we lie, if we're not nice to someone, if we take something we're not supposed to or do something our parents told us not to do, raise your hand if you've ever done something wrong. Congregation, you can join on this. Raise your hand if you've ever done something wrong. Take a look around you. I want to see. Look around. Everybody's hand is up, right? Well, how do we get clean from something we've done inside or from something we've done wrong? Will water do it? No, it won't. But what we know, how do we get clean inside? We love God because we know that Jesus has forgiven us, hasn't he? Well, we have something we call a sacrament, and a sacrament's a big word. It means we do something we can see for something that happens inside us. We baptize so that we can get clean inside us, that we know that Jesus has forgiven us. This is our baptismal font right here. And we baptize people to remind them and to bring them into the family of God. And by baptizing them, we say, "You are forgiven in Jesus Christ." Raise your hand if you're baptized. Look around you. Look around. See, everyone here is baptized. And what we do in baptism is we have water in here, and then we take that water and we say, "You are baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." And we do that, we know that God has forgiven us in Christ. Let us pray. God, we thank you for cleansing us, for forgiving our sins in Jesus Christ. Help us to remember our baptism each day. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen. Okay, if you can go with Miss Ashley. Please pray with me. O God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of every heart here be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, there's an old saying that the three words every woman wants to hear is, I love you. And the two words that every man wants to hear are, play ball. I searched online, and one woman shared an updated list of the three words that she would love to hear. They are, you are hired, I trust you, tell me more, I miss you, and finally, 50% off sale. I was thinking, as your pastor, what are the four words that every pastor would love to hear? I found these on the internet. I'll pray for you. I'll volunteer to help. I will encourage you. Your sermon touched me. And finally, I promise to be in church every Sunday with no excuses unless providentially hindered by God. Okay, I know that's a little bit more than four words. It's actually 16 words. It's not only pastors who can get wordy. Well, when you read through the Bible, especially some of the Old Testament, you may think that God gets a little wordy. Well, today I want to look at the 16 words that God loves to hear the most. And those 16 words are these: I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. These 16 words signal that one person who has been lost is now found, and that brings God great joy. This is Christ's mission, to bring the lost children to God, back to God. We're continuing our sermon series today on our mission statement, and again, I invite you to turn to the back of your bulletin, if you will, and we're going to recite this together. Would you join me as we say our mission statement together? As followers of Jesus Christ, under the authority of the Bible, our mission is glorifying and worshiping God, baptizing and strengthening disciples, loving and serving all people. Well, within this sermon series, this will be a two-part sermon. The second point of our mission statement is to baptize and strengthen disciples. It's a two-part statement, to baptize and to strengthen. Today we'll see in our scripture from Matthew that to make disciples is also a two-part process. It's to baptize and to teach. To baptize in the name of the Holy Trinity and to teach people the commandments that Jesus gave his disciples. This Sunday we'll be looking at baptizing, and next Sunday, teaching. Well, as disciples of Jesus Christ, our mission is to fulfill Christ's mission, to go make disciples of all nations. And there are three things we need to do if we're going to fulfill God's mission, Christ's mission, in this area. We need to go, evangelize, and baptize. Christ calls us to go make disciples of all nations. This command to go is not a new command. Earlier in the chapter, Jesus had instructed the women who had met him outside the tomb on Easter to go and tell his disciples, to go tell his disciples to go to Galilee. It was a command that they followed willingly. Jesus' command was relayed by the women to the disciples. Go to Galilee and see Jesus. God has been calling people to go ever since the time of Genesis. He told Abraham, go to a land that I will show you, the promised land. He told Moses to go to Egypt and rescue the Hebrew people. He told Jonah, go to Nineveh and call the people there to repent. God instructed his prophets like Isaiah and Jeremiah to go to his people and proclaim God's word. Go is an action word. It's a word that sets us in motion. The gospel is to be in motion. The church is to be in motion to spread the gospel to the world. But go is also a following word. A word of action that follows God's commands. following the mission that Christ has given us. Go is a word following the authority of Christ. It's the word that comes immediately after Christ proclaims, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given unto me." All authority. All authority in heaven and authority on earth. Complete and total authority resides in Jesus, the Son of God. And he commands his disciples to go. Go is the word that launches our mission to the whole world. Jesus said, go to all nations. In Pastor Diana's sermon last week, she talked about all nations, all people worshiping God through Jesus Christ. The Jews and the Samaritans together would worship God through Jesus, the Messiah. Well, today we are celebrating worldwide communion, recognizing that the gospel of Jesus Christ has reached all over the world. Christians of all nations are celebrating communion today. And it's appropriate that we are reminded on Worldwide Communion Sunday of Christ's call to go to all nations. To have all nations worshiping God, all nations must first be disciples of God. It's important to recognize the challenging call that Jesus is putting on the disciples' shoulders. He is challenging them to move out beyond their community, beyond their culture, and beyond their comfort zones to go make disciples. He is sending the disciples to foreign places. You know, Jesus and his disciples were all raised in the Jewish culture, the Jewish religion. They had been taught from early on that they were the chosen people. And you also heard in last week's sermon how in the culture, Jews did not associate with Samaritans or other Gentiles. The disciples are being challenged to go not to their own people, to the people of God. They're being challenged to go beyond that. But here is Jesus calling them to move beyond their comfort zone. You know, we all feel comfortable in the culture we were raised in, the culture that we're defined by. That can be defined by geography, by growing up in Wyoming. It can be defined by race. It can be defined by economics. It can be defined by language or ideology. Whatever culture we're raised in is where we feel most comfortable. But Christ is calling us as disciples to move beyond that culture, to go beyond our comfort zone, to move beyond it and make disciples of all nations. The challenge for disciples is not to wait for others to come to us, but to venture out into the uncomfortable arena of other nations and other cultures and take the gospel to them. And go the disciples did. Thomas went to Syria and Iran and then to southern India. Andrew was sent to Scythia. Peter appears to have preached in Galatia, Cappadocia, and then to the Jews in Asia. Paul took the gospel of Jesus Christ from Jerusalem all the way to what is now Albania. The disciples were in motion with the gospel. Well, going to all nations, we fulfill Christ's mission by making disciples and baptizing them. Notice something here. Notice the equitable and horizontal nature of Jesus' mission. He's telling disciples to go make disciples. There's a level of equality here. You know, the past 2 weeks in our sermons, we've been talking about glorifying and worshiping God. Our direction has been vertical, reaching high towards God the Almighty. Visually, our hearts and our minds were directed upward like our hands being lifted and reaching out to God. Well, these next 2 weeks, our arms are in mission mode, horizontal, like Christ's outstretched arms when he was sacrificed on the cross. Our emphasis this week is to take the mission out to other disciples, to humanity, to show God's love to those around us. Well, the Christian faith was once described as one beggar telling another beggar where to find food. That's a quote from D.T. Niles describing evangelism. Oh, there's that dreaded E word, evangelism. We Presbyterians tend to shy away from evangelism. Do you know how much 1 million kilos of evangelism weighs? 1 billygram. The word evangelism conjures up images of Christians shouting the gospel from street corners or going door to door. But we don't need to let those uncomfortable and outdated images prevent us from doing the most important mission work Christ has called us to, the mission to go out and tell people about the gospel. Evangelism is important to Presbyterians. We still have evangelism in our mission. It's simply sharing the good news of Jesus Christ with those around us. One of the ways our denomination does evangelism is to share the gospel with people to what we call 1,001 new worshiping communities. These are worshiping communities that are not in your typical brick and mortar church. They have taken the gospel out into the community and meet people where they are. We have two such in our presbytery. They are called The Table in Casper and also Pine Ridge Ministries near Moorcroft. They are taking the gospel out and reaching the people in the community. But it's not enough to leave evangelism to others, to rely on someone else to tell people about the love of God. Our mission, our call as disciples, is to share how Jesus has touched our lives. The goal, of course, in sharing the good news is so that others will come to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And there's two pieces of good news about evangelism. First, opening people's hearts and minds to the gospel and God's love is not our responsibility. It's God's. It's the Holy Spirit that changes people's hearts. It's the Holy Spirit that opens their hearts to hear the good news. We are called to spread the word of God like a sower sows seed out in the field. And Jesus told his disciples to go out into the communities to tell people about God. But he says, quote, "If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, shake the dust off your feet as you leave that home or town." As disciples, we are called to share the love of God in our lives and let the Holy Spirit do the rest. Our church's Book of Confession says this: "Christian baptism marks the receiving of the same Spirit by Christ's people." John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist Church, came to believe in Jesus Christ because he felt the Spirit touched his heart. He wrote this, quote, I went very unwillingly to a society where someone was reading Luther's preface to Romans. And while he was describing the change which God works in the heart through faith in Christ, I felt my heart strangely warmed. The Holy Spirit had touched him. C.S. Lewis, the famous Christian author, was an outspoken atheist in his early life. He compares his conversion to Christianity like a prodigal son, kicking and screaming and struggling, resentful, looking for a chance to escape. And he writes this of his conversion, quote, "I know very well when, but hardly how, the final step was taken. I was driving to Whipsnade one morning. When we set out, I did not believe that Jesus Christ was the Son of God. And when we reached there, I did." The second piece of good news about evangelism is that we do not do it alone. Jesus promised in this passage, "I will be with you till the end of the age." Christ is with us every step of the way as we tell others about the love of God. Of course, faith in Jesus Christ is the requirement for baptism. The question we ask when we baptize someone, who is your Lord and Savior? Will you be a faithful disciple? And in baptism, we are cleansed from our sins, adopted into God's family as children of God. The first question we ask in baptism is, do you renounce sin, its power on you? Psalm 51 that was read this morning, the psalmist recognizes the need for cleansing from sin. "Have mercy on me, O God. Blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. Purge me and I shall be clean. Wash me and I will be whiter than snow." Our Book of Confession says, "We are baptized with water, for the water washes dirt away and cools and refreshes tired bodies. And the grace of God performs these things for our souls, as does so invisibly and spiritually." And in baptism, we are adopted by God into the family of God. Our Book of Confession states, baptism, once received, continues for all of life. It's a perpetual sealing of our adoption. And in that adoption, we are enrolled, entered, and received into the covenant and family of God, into the inheritance of children of God. We are called a child of God. God has adopted us through faith in Jesus Christ, sealed through baptism. And that baptism is a wonderful symbol of what is taking place. For in adoption, God is choosing us. God is saying, I want you to be part of my family. As those already adopted into God's family, our mission is to tell others that God loves them, to invite them to be part of the family of God. Our church has made Christ's mission our mission. To fulfill Christ's mission, we have to go out into the world beyond our comfort zones. We have to evangelize, tell the people the good news of God's love. And we have to baptize. Baptize in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Baptize and let people experience their sins forgiven. Baptize and let them experience the love of God as a child of God. It is good today that we are both talking about baptism and celebrating the Lord's Supper. The two sacraments together are the visible images of God's love and grace and mercy. The Lord's Supper fills us again with the good news that through Christ's death and resurrection, we have been reconciled to God. Baptism is the reminder that we are forgiven, cleansed from our sin, and adopted into God's family. So I invite you today, as you approach the communion table, the table of grace, or at home as you are gathering around the elements that you have prepared, to renew in your hearts your baptismal vows. Remember those favorite 16 words, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and you will bring God great joy. Amen.
Traditional for Communion Sunday, so please join me in the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of the Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And we believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And we believe one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and we look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated. And now let us come before our Lord in prayer. Let us pray. From every place on this planet, we turn our face to you, O God. Gather us, all your people, together to pray as one on this World Communion Sunday. In the midst of the forces which would separate us, bind us in your love as the Church together. Our God, who is our Creator God, our Heavenly Father, bless us in this celebration today. Bless us with discomfort at easy answers, half-truths, and superficial relationships. Bless us with anger at injustice, oppression, and exploitation of people. Bless us with tears to shed for those who suffer from pain, rejection, starvation, and war. Bless us with enough foolishness to believe that we can make a difference in this world. Strengthen us through the grace of your people gathered, no matter how we gather, with the truth of your Spirit's presence. In a world aching to be made new, we cry out with those who suffer the pains of what powers and principalities extract from the world's poorest. We cry out for those suffering from illness and disease, from mental illness, drug and alcohol addiction, at whom the world turns a callous glance. Today we lift to you, our great physician, those for whom this congregation has been asked to pray, all those on our prayer list, those close in our hearts, and for Dolores Gunn, recovering from a stroke, for Sherry Hayes, for Jim O'Connor, who will undergo surgery, for Tyler Pratt, and for Ricky Rowland, a 9-year-old who spent several weeks in Children's Hospital in Denver, for Royce Parrott, Barb Lutz's father, and for our president and his wife. Grant them your healing spirit and bring them to a place of wholeness and wellness. We cry out with those stinging from the sins of white supremacy. We cry out for those seeking justice, equality, and peace. Peace at all times and in all ways. We cry out for those who are fighting fires, those whose lives have been devastated by loss due to fires in the West and hurricanes in the East. We cry out for those suffering loss of life due to COVID and those who are on the front lines caring for the ill. We cry out for those in our faith community who have lost loved ones, for the family and friends of Margaret Smith and Dave Huebner. We pray for Donna DeNino's family on the loss of her sister-in-law. Wrap them in your love and peace. And we pray for the Carline family as Connie's father transitions into eternal life. Give Give Connie and Edie the strength, courage, and faith they need in this time. And we cry out for families for whom the stresses of family living have led to violence, neglect, or division. We pray for those who are now experiencing homelessness. Help them to find the resources they need to live in security, dignity, love, and peace. In a world stretching toward wholeness, we celebrate with those whose lives bear the fruit of your spirit and seek to share in your call to partnership. We celebrate with those whose efforts are making the world new. We celebrate with all who gather to earnestly seek your transforming work in the world. Make us a world that grows into the shape of your communion table, where all are welcome and all are fed. Make us a people who grow your family by practices of mutuality, generosity, and justice. And may we be found to be witnesses when Jesus returns to the truth of who we are, who we were created to be, people who belong to each other, people who belong to you. O God, in your Son Jesus, we pray. And now, as Jesus taught his disciples, we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Let us give thanks to the Lord with all our being. In the company of the upright, let us honor God for the blessings and goodness we have received. In response to God, we offer our lives and our gifts. We invite you to prepare your offering and leave them in the offering plates as you are dismissed, or through our church website or by mail.
seems appropriate that the first time we take communion together after many months is on Worldwide Communion Sunday. Let us now prepare our hearts to receive this sacrament. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
If you are here in person with us, when the time comes, you'll be invited to come forward to take your mask off and hold your hand out. Pastor Diana and I will put a piece of bread in your hand. You can take and eat it, and then go to the next station where a cup will be there for you to drink, and then to toss the cup in a trash can to the side. If you're taking the elements at home, you'll be invited just to partake them during this time. Let us pray. Holy and right it is, and our joyful duty to give thanks to you, O Lord, our Creator, at all times and in all places. We are thankful that through the power of your Holy Spirit, the good news of Christ's love has been shared with people all over the world. Heavenly Father, show forth among us the presence of your life-giving word and Holy Spirit. Sanctify us and your whole church through this sacrament. Grant that all who share the body and blood of our Savior Jesus Christ may be one in him and may remain faithful in love and hope. As this grain has been gathered from many fields into one loaf, and these grapes from many hills into one cup, grant, O Lord, that your whole church may gather together in unity, and may your church serve you faithfully in all regions of the world, through Christ our Lord. Amen. On the night Jesus betrayed, he gathered his disciples around the table, and after giving thanks, he took bread, and he broke it, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. Take and eat."
On that same evening, he took a cup and he poured it, and he blessed it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and drink. This is the cup of the new covenant, sealed with my blood, shed for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink of it, do so in remembrance of me."
Thank you.
body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. And now go out into the world, following Christ's call to tell people about the love of God and inviting them to become part of the family of God. And now may God bless you, and give you peace. May the Lord lift up his face to you and give you his peace, now and forever. Amen.